I just saw, like, you know, before, you know, it was like printed photos of like a hotel room. So imagine, like, imagine your quintessential hotel or motel room. You open the door and you see like two beds, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the picture had these two beds and it was just like Kevlar vests on them.
I'm like, what?
I'm like, why? First of all, what? Second of all,
why
are there, why are there Kevlar vests in this picture?
In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, what's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Genius Brain Podcast. How glorious of a week it is. Hamilton is out on Disney Plus.
Yeah, that's right.
Did you see a Hamilton live?
I haven't yet, no.
You know that shit's fucking expensive?
What?
Hamilton, like, live.
Expensive to
watch.
To watch
it's fucking expensive.
Wait, it's not included in the Disney Plus thing?
No, I'm talking about alive.
Oh, like, yeah, in real life.
Yeah, not on Disney.
Yeah,
Plus,
I was
dude.
About to say, I'm like, you gotta pay extra for that shit?
No, Disney, when, so I watched Hamilton live, yeah, in New York.
On Broadway. Yeah.
Because I was in New York for a Thrillist shoot with Tim.
Right.
And then we were going to spend Valentine's Day together without our lady. So that's, we went to go watch Hamilton instead.
That's
so
hot.
Yeah, so me and Tim, we went to go watch Hamilton. And then, yeah, I didn't know what to expect out of it because I just, so Tim actually put me on to Book of Mormon. And so,
yeah.
The Book of Mormon was amazing, by the way.
Was it?
It's super fucking funny.
It was the South Park guys that did it, right?
Yeah, the South Park guys. Yeah. And they kind of have like the comedic twist of, you know, the Mormon religion.
Yeah.
And they kind of tell it through song and dance. And it's really fucking funny.
Right.
It's probably one of the, like, I was tearing up laughing. Like, I was, as if I was at a stand-up comedy show.
Damn.
That's how fucking funny it is.
Wait, you saw the live action, like the in real life version,
yeah,
of that?
And I saw that in New York too.
Oh, wow.
Because I was in New York a lot because of all the food stuff that I was doing.
I remember that.
And then when we watched Hamilton was one of those things, like, if you guys haven't seen it on Disney Plus, you guys should. It's not the same, obviously.
Yeah.
But just, I remember just watching it, just cracking up, and then also crying towards the end. And I didn't expect to, like, tear up from the play, because I'm not a big musical guy.
Well, is this rooted in like, obviously Alexander Hamilton, that's his name, right?
Yeah.
It's rooted in a real story, right? It's not.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's a lot of creative freedom in it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it's not so accurately told. Like, for example, Alexander Hamilton, you know, they only talk about his one son, his 9-year-old son.
Okay.
Well, obviously he grew up and he was like 19 years old later.
Right.
And that's when he died.
Yeah.
But he had a total of, like, I forgot. Don't quote me on this, but I think he had a total of like 7 or 8 kids. And a lot of them weren't with his wife. So he cheated on his wife with multiple people.
Oh shit.
I think I read too, he actually, he had like a half black, half white kid too. I think he had an affair with a freed black woman.
Oh, got it.
As well. So he,
a lot of history.
He was fucking promiscuous as fuck.
Yeah.
And so, They obviously had their own creative freedom with it, but I think I read recently too, people have been asking for people to cancel Hamilton, the
really
play.
What, because of the, like, his historic kind of role? And
well, because of the whole BLM thing, obviously.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
you know,
right,
black rights is a huge topic right now,
for sure.
And so Alexander Hamilton, though he didn't own slaves himself, mm-hmm, apparently he was involved in the slave trade. So I believe his wife's family sold slaves or traded slaves, and he did the accounting for it or something like that.
Oh, okay.
Don't quote me on that.
But so he was involved in that mechanism.
So
somehow
he was involved in the slave trade thing. Yeah. And I think, like, you know, when you watch Hamilton too, like, even in one of the raps, he kind of like disses other people in there because he doesn't own slaves.
Oh, I see.
They're asking for Hamilton to be canceled because he was involved in the slave trade.
Yeah, right.
Which is so interesting because I don't know how I feel about that.
Hmm.
Because people on Twitter and also social media have been getting really, riled up about this country's history. And it's been like this for a while.
Yeah.
I don't know what if I were to ask somebody, because people know I'm like deep into BLM too, mm-hmm, but I want to know what the objective is. Mm. When you are not so much scrutinizing the history, because history is history for a reason. It happened.
For sure.
You're not going to change it.
Right, right.
Because you're upset about it now, you're not going to change the fact that this happened, that this country was founded on these things, right?
Right, right.
I understand when you walk around and you see these monuments that represent slavery and the terrible things that are done, and you don't want to see it.
Yeah.
I get it.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess, like, objectively, this is not my opinion. I'm just kind of asking. It's, mm-hmm, when you ask for the show, the Broadway show Hamilton, to be canceled, that, mm-hmm, was created by Lin-Manuel,
right,
that's almost exclusively an all black cast.
Yeah.
What is the objective? You know?
Mm.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think one thing, it's important to obviously not forget about history, right? Like what has happened. And mm-hmm. me as a foreigner, it's something I'm still like catching up on, like American history. Like I never learned that shit and
yeah.
growing up in Europe. But on the other hand, it's hard to really, I guess, make amendments for the past by constantly, you know, barraging it, right? Or bringing it up. I think what's more important is how, what can you learn from it and how can you move forward based on where we're at right now, you know?
And then, yeah. And I'm just kind of curious too, just, I mean, this might be being, you know, kind of scrutinizing it a little bit.
Yeah.
It's, you know, people are protesting to, you know, for the whole like, oh, don't call Aunt Jemima, you know, yeah. all this other stuff, you right, know, right. which is fine.
Yeah.
But what about the policies? Yeah, yeah. I mean, we need change in policy
totally,
first.
Totally, 100%.
So you got to realize too, that's all smoke and mirrors.
Yeah.
You know, what you guys are asking for in terms of change,
yeah.
you guys are asking for the monuments to be torn down or whatever.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, I don't think that really does shit. That's yeah. really important to stuff that I want changed now.
Yeah.
You know, and I think a lot of people are like, well, it's better than nothing. And I completely disagree with that.
Yeah.
Something is not always better than nothing.
For sure.
You guys have to realize that, yeah, people will give you the small things that you want just yeah. to appease you for now. So right. they don't have to deal with bigger issues.
Right, right.
So, you know, when we talk about defund the police and we're talking about police reform,
yeah,
and then there's this other agenda where they go, well, let's cancel Hamilton because he owned slaves.
Yeah.
In my personal opinion, I don't give a fuck about that. Right. Not right now anyways. Yeah. If you guys want to tackle that later, that's perfectly fine.
Right, right.
We have bigger issues right now where, yeah. you know, young black men and young black women are fucking dying right now.
Yeah.
And it's not because of these monuments that are erected up that was done like yeah. from 300 or 400 years in our yeah. history right now.
Right.
I think seeing that is something that's troublesome. It bothers people
yeah.
because now they're finding out about what these people did and you right. have to see it. However, let's kind of shift and tackle what's important right now.
Yeah, the foundational issues, right? The
yeah.
systemic issues. And I totally agree. And you actually brought up a good point. Like I went down to some of these protests when they were in the heat, like when they're happening at a high frequency. I mean, they still happen now,
mm-hmm.
but I feel like it's kind of like lost a little bit of its steam.
Yeah.
At least in real life, I know people are still very active online and stuff like that. But one thing that I did hear a lot at those protests were defund the police, right? Like the whole concept of just taking funds away or resources away from the police foundation or whatever,
yeah.
maybe like whatever budgets they have available. My bigger thing is like, rather than just like taking money away, wouldn't it be more or better to figure out like how they're spending the money that they do have right now? Like is 90% of their budgets going towards gear? Like, you know, how police are getting more militarized and stuff, mm-hmm. right? Wouldn't it be better to route some of that money to more of a training or something like that instead? So I don't think for me, it's hard to align with the whole defunding part and more so like, how can we keep them better accountable for how they're spending the funds that they're actually getting?
Yeah, we had a conversation with a couple of friends of mine on this podcast about that. And we you know, I've discussed it with quite a few people, even
yeah.
some former cops and stuff, obviously.
Yeah.
I've been trying to get a cop on here that's currently, you know, enlisted in the police
yeah.
force, but
right.
they don't want to come on. And obviously it's a
yeah.
PR thing. So
right,
I completely
for sure.
understand.
For sure.
But there's a lot of situations that cops are put into that I don't think should be in the scope of their job.
Mm.
Like, for example, like we talked about cops de-escalating situations with people who are, for example, on the spectrum.
Right.
Right.
right yeah.
I don't think that they are, number one, emotionally prepared for that. And
yeah.
number two, they're not just prepared for that situation in general.
Right.
There's like social workers who deal with like emotionally and mentally erratic people
yeah.
and they don't have weapons and they don't have guns
right.
and they can de-escalate these situations really well.
Right, right.
So these cops are also put into those situations and expected to know
yeah.
how to handle these things.
Yeah.
They're not given mental assessments. They're not done. There's a lot of stuff that they have to do that's within the scope of their work
yeah.
that I think they could split up to other people.
Right.
So to what you were saying,
yeah.
it's, you know, can that money be allocated somewhere else where it's not just cops going to these scenes? Like, for example,
right.
like, you know, when bad things happen, let's say somebody's like emotionally erratic
yeah.
and they'll call the cops on this person
right.
to get them to calm down. Like, should a cop be in that situation?
Right. Exactly.
Probably fucking not.
Nah,
you
right.
should probably send somebody else in there,
yeah,
like
exactly.
a social worker or something. Like, I don't know what that job title pertains to or
yeah.
who you can send in,
right.
but I don't think a cop is the appropriate person to go in there.
Yeah.
And if it
sure.
is, and that's the scope of their job, they're not handling it very well at all.
Right. Right.
So yeah, there's like rhetoric is very important too. I think like defunding the police was a very
yeah.
terrible title. To
yeah, no, I agree. I mean, I get the spirit behind that, right? But I just think, like you said, it's maybe not the right way to word it necessarily. Yeah.
So maybe retrain and reallocate.
Yeah, reallocate would be
would be better. I think because when I was watching a lot of these articles, I remember I saw this one video where I forgot what city it was, and people could probably tell me in the comments, but it was a cop, or it was like the chief of police representing his policeman, and you see his policeman standing behind him like a bunch of fucking 4-year-olds.
Was it the police union guy?
I think so, right? And he goes, these cops back here, they're fighting, and you're hurting their feelings. Right. Like, shut the fuck up, dude. it literally looked like somebody's Karen-ass looking mom defending them at fucking elementary school, telling them not to bully their kids. Right, it's like, bro, shut the fuck up,
dude.
That was a bad PR move. It just doesn't look right. They had their hands, you know, crossed in front of them, and they're sitting there with their heads down. Yep. It's like, bro,
and they were all of one persuasion too, right?
Yeah,
in the back, you know.
So it's weird, man, just watching how things are kind of going down in this country. And I think for you especially, if you guys don't know, like, Z is not from here.
Yeah, right. I'm European, actually Swedish, but I'm sure you guys can tell. I've been here for a good minute, right? And still finding myself learning about just a lot of the history, and because you can get a surface level understanding based on the internet and things that just kind of come by you on a day-to-day basis, but really diving into a lot of the history of this country and the traditions, like, for instance, the whole redlining thing. Mm-hmm. When they used to zone in the Jim Crow era, when colored people or minorities weren't able to buy property in certain areas, and that how that has affected the whole community's wealth in general, mm-hmm. as it passes down generations. Because a lot of times, we see a lot of wealthy people and we just assume that, they made it, right? But mm-hmm. a lot of times they've had a solid foundation to build upon.
Yeah.
Right. And in most instances, it's based on what? Businesses being inherited or passed down, or property, real estate. Mm-hmm. really, that if you look at the most wealthy people aside from Jeff Bezos, what do they have in common? They work in real estate or insurance.
Yeah,
those are the in my opinion, from what I've seen, seem to be the two behemoths of sectors.
Really, yeah, but driving. Even those stories too are kind of exaggerated. So people for example, Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos, right? Yeah. They kind of take their stories and they say, Jeff Bezos is a guy that from his small little garage over here in whatever,
right?
He built his empire through hard work and $0. But in reality, that wasn't the case.
Right.
I forgot. I mean, I read this a long time ago, but I think he got money from his parents. It was a pretty huge sum.
Right.
I think from his parents, actually helped him out and get his foot through the door. Even with Bill Gates, Bill Gates had a huge help from his mom, I believe. I think she had connections with IBM.
Yeah.
So, when people talk about these success stories too, you can't just take it for what you've heard. You have to really see what actually happened.
Yeah.
So totally. Bill Gates' mom had a connection to IBM and kind of set up his future. It wasn't just Bill Gates created this genius idea and somebody was like, hey, by the way, I like that. Here's a bunch of money.
Yeah.
He was connected through wealth.
Yeah.
Jeff Bezos was connected through wealth.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't like they were from some third world country.
Yeah. For sure.
They're not refugees from fucking Vietnam or Thailand or some shit like that or like refugee Chinese people.
That had bootstrapped themselves up or something, right?
Exactly. Yeah. It's not that same story.
Yeah.
And then people don't want to kind of recognize that and they go, well, they did it this way. It's but you didn't hear the whole thing. And even when you tell people this, they tend to ignore it.
Right. Yeah. And it's not like, it's not like there's anything wrong with that, right? It's great and good for them, to be honest. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I think we don't realize as well, the peace of mind that they have going into being entrepreneurial or trying to do something. They don't have the same types of stresses that, people who may have just come here might have. Surviving. That might not even be a concept that is very familiar with them because they have a solid foundation.
Yeah.
They have a household that has the ability to maybe support them financially or had an upbringing where they've been allowed or given the luxury of being entrepreneurial and not thinking about, okay, how can I get money to support my family?
Yeah. And, one of the arguments that I consistently hear online for people who aren't for who just kind of don't understand a lot of the plight of people, like, for example, like the Black community, right? One of the biggest things that I always hear is that this podcast is brought to you by Skillshare. Are you that type of person that wants to start or explore a passion, but you think you don't have the time, or maybe you just don't know where to start? That's where Skillshare comes in, my friend. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of inspiring classes to help you explore new skills and learn things on your own time and schedule. You are just like me. You can't tell me when to learn, son. There are so many things that I want to do and learn, and Skillshare has so many online classes that I can choose from that I love. The classes are endless, and if you're someone like me that loves learning shit and doing it on our own time, what are you waiting for? Right now, I'm going through a course called Filmmaking from Home, and the tips that I've gotten from this course I use in my videos today. That's right, I still use them now. Explore your creativity and get 2 free months of premium membership at skillshare.com/brain. That's 2 whole months of unlimited access to thousands of classes for free. Get started and join today by heading to skillshare.com/brain. That's 2 free months of unlimited access to thousands of classes at skillshare.com/brain. At a certain point, they said you have to be personally responsible and just kind of like pick yourselves up by your bootstraps or whatever, right? Which I understand. There is a high level of personal responsibility when it comes to getting yourself out of a socioeconomic area that you want to, you want to climb that socioeconomic ladder,
right?
But you also have to recognize the stuff that was done to a certain community to keep him down that way,
right?
So, because it's a lot easier said than done. Yeah. And so we talk about these rules that happen. They say, well, there's these laws that kind of prevented there was these laws that were created to give them a leg up, right? Yeah. Whether it's affirmative action, whether there was certain things that were banned for people not to do or whatever.
Right.
Just because these laws are put in place doesn't mean people follow these rules.
Yeah.
It's such a dumb concept. Like, anybody can agree to this. Like, anybody understands. Like, for example, we were told not to wear masks wherever we go.
Yep.
It was told by our government. Did people follow those rules? Something as simple as that. Mm-hmm. So you talk about a country that was based on racism, mm-hmm. right? Or just a group of people in this country that maintained a huge sum of the power, and on top of that, looked at these people as if they were less than for a majority of their lives, and then overnight they go, okay, well, from now on, now they're your equals.
Yeah,
like everybody was on board with that shit.
Yeah,
you know, like it doesn't work that way. You guys can't even wear a mask when you go outside when you're told to do so. What makes you think that this was any easier?
Yeah,
and there's like a ripple effect that happens.
Yeah,
and I think like because people don't want to recognize it, I think that's probably the bigger issue why people get upset and pissed off. Mm-hmm. So I do understand that we do have a certain level of personal responsibility, but with that personal responsibility, people do have to recognize that you are in a position because you were set up to succeed.
Yeah,
and some people in this country weren't.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
And if when you kind of get that, then you have like room for empathy and understanding. Yeah.
That's where the whole systemic thing comes in. Right?
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's a term that we hear a lot, like systemic racism or systemic institutional issues, mm-hmm. right? That are holding a certain group of people behind. But sometimes it's like it's just a word, and it requires us as individuals and as like citizens of the world to really just dig into what that really means.
Yeah.
You know, like it really took me, like I watched a few videos online and read into it and found out about this whole redlining thing. Like I mentioned earlier, like, you know, certain Black folks back in the day weren't able to borrow money to buy property mm-hmm. to then generate wealth for their subsequent generations.
Yeah.
Whereas the, you know, people in the white community had a much easier time to borrow money, get property, and then pass that down, and then there.
And you know what's really interesting? If you have I saw this HBO thing, but it was basically this UK stand-up comic, right?
Yeah.
And he goes around and he interviews and he gets to understand the life of people who don't like his skin color.
Oh,
or whether it's like hardcore like white nationalists,
yeah,
whether or it's just like the KKK here. And he even think he even like stayed and interviewed they're called Black supremacists. So are the opposite of white supremacists, yeah. And they believe, you know.
Yeah.
And it was really weird watching it because watching it didn't make me agree with the KKK,
right.
But it gave them a perspective of what they're thinking in their head.
Yeah.
So when he went to go interview this couple, and he actually stayed with them, shared a meal with them, and they mm-hmm. were very polite and very cordial to him, which kind of threw me off.
Right.
And in between watching him go there and have a conversation with them and share a meal,
yeah.
He's also doing a little stand-up set in between about what he experienced.
Right.
So he was sitting down and he had a conversation with the wife of the guy. and they have a young child. They have two kids, I believe. Mm-hmm. And he was asking her basically, you know, what's her fear of black people? Mm-hmm. Like, where does her fear come from? She goes, she sees that her culture is disappearing and she wants to make sure that her kid grows up in a world that's safe and there's white people for them to see.
Yeah.
And so it was odd listening to that because it's like, that's so funny because you have this very, in my personal opinion, a very irrational fear of your power being stripped away.
Right.
Or you're not going to see, you're afraid that white people are disappearing in this country, even though the percentage is ridiculous.
Oh, yeah.
But it's like, I think it's like 15% of this country is like made of black Americans. Mm-hmm. So it's, the percentage is ridiculous.
Yeah, vast majority are still European
white. Still European white ancestry, right? Yeah. And so they see that disappearing and they see, you know, everybody who's other as a threat. So it's funny because that's how we view you, but you guys are in the majority.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this weird disconnect that's happening in this country. When I heard that shit, I was kind of surprised. Yeah. And then he went over to Europe. I think it was like Russia or Moscow. Yeah. And there was a bunch of white nationalists there.
Yeah.
And you want to hear the funniest thing, the oddest thing. There was a guy that was talking to him and he was trying to convince the host, the black dude, that he should be racist. He was like, He didn't understand why him as a black man isn't racist. He goes, why aren't you racist? He goes, what do you mean?
Yeah.
He goes, you should be racist. He goes, I'm okay as a white nationalist. I'm okay with you coming to my country and doing whatever.
Right.
But after you're done, leave. Get out of here. You shouldn't be here.
Hmm.
And he looked at him. He goes, why aren't you racist? He goes, if I was in your country and I wanted to stay, you should tell me to get the fuck out. Like, I shouldn't be there.
That's interesting.
What a weird, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so it kind of like made me pause. It was like, what the fuck? Like, I, you know, because in my mind, I had this blanket idea of what a white nationalist is. It was like, I fucking hate black people. I hate Asian people. I hate anybody who looks different than me.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's the case. I think white nationalists, not that I say I agree with them.
Right.
I don't. But I'm saying just from that, I gain a perspective of they are just intolerant to people who are other if they kind of disrupt their personal way of life.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't see the same people that look like them that live here, like they're okay if you're curious about their culture, you want to come here.
Yeah.
But if you want to live here, set up structure and have a say in what they do, they want you the fuck out.
Yeah. So maybe separate those two terms, like white nationalists being what they are. White just happens to be what they look like. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And he was trying to say, like, you should be racist.
That's
he was like, it's a good thing. You should be racist.
Yeah.
You should be. And I think what he was trying to say is that you should be prideful of your own culture and you shouldn't let people take over your land,
mm-hmm.
which is so fucking odd.
It is. It is. I think, you know, maybe because we're, you know, millennials that we grew up in an era where it's just internationalism, right?
Yeah.
Where it's hard for us. And again, I don't agree with his point of view there either. I think that, you know, this is a world where it'd be better off if we are integrated rather than segregated.
Well, because the problem with that is that when you do that, you deny history, right?
Yeah.
It's like, motherfucker, you can't, as a white, if a white nationalist in the United States, when you say, hey, you should go back to Africa, bitch, you brought them here.
Yeah, that's true.
What the fuck?
Right.
You brought their ancestors here. They didn't come here. They came here as chattel, as property, as slaves. So what the fuck are you talking about?
Rob them of their culture and traditions.
Exactly.
And,
you force that upon them. If you want them the fuck out of here, or you want me out of here too, send me back, give me some fucking money, set me up for life, and then I'm good to go. I'll get the fuck out of here immediately. Let me know.
Yeah.
If you could go ahead and rebuild my podcast all the way out in Korea and they got space for me out there and I have a job and I have a career and I can make good money, then send me the fuck over there with me and my family and then we're good to go. But you ain't going to do that.
Yeah.
You know?
Right. And the world is going to be a lot less exciting if, if that were the case. Dude, can you imagine?
It'd be weird.
It'd be so weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, I don't think that's going to happen. Yeah.
I mean, because you're, are you an American citizen? No.
No.
You're still a Swedish citizen, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Why'd you want to come here? Because I thought Sweden is supposed to be the land of promise.
You know, I don't know, land of promise, land of security.
Security, Elsa.
Yeah, for sure. It is that.
Sweden is social?
It is definitely, they call themselves social democrats. It's a socially democratic thing. So it's like, if you look at the political scale, it's definitely left-leaning.
Mm-hmm.
And not left-leaning as in like the Dems are here. Because even though the Dems are more left-leaning than the Republicans, they're still on the right side of the scale. Being more, you know, more of commercialism and more just all about like commerce and wealth building. And you as an individual versus you as a group, as a nation, right? So it's definitely, when you say safe, or when I say safe, it's not like, oh, it's safer to go out at night. Not that type of safety. It's like a life safety or life security, whereas like you're always going to be okay. Like you're not going to be homeless unless you really want to. Like there are people who are homeless that, and I'm not saying this that like I know it, but from when I grew up, I knew that if you were homeless, like if you didn't have a home, there was always an option for you to get housing. Like,
oh, really?
Yeah. The government would sponsor you. Right. So that's the whole safety net that I would be referring to, is like, if you lost your job, as long as you're actively looking for something, you're always going to be okay. Like they'll help you out in the meantime. They'll pay for your rent. They'll pay for your food. You know, they'll give you stipends, really? Basically. Right. Until you get back on your feet. Right. So, and the whole thing with healthcare is the same thing. Like it definitely is more of like where Bernie was trying to take things.
Mm.
Like he was, based on what I understood, he was definitely looking at a lot of the Scandinavian countries for inspiration in terms of what he believed to be the right way to run things.
Yeah.
Which would be like, hey, there are certain rights that you have as a resident or as a citizen of a country that you shouldn't have to risk losing.
Mm.
Like decouple the whole healthcare thing from your job, right? Like you as a person should have the right, or as a taxpayer should have the right to get healthcare that you need without it being like contingent upon where you work.
Yeah.
Or about how much money you're making. Because look at it this way, like even though if you have insurance, that shit can still rack up a lot of, like,
oh, for
in terms
sure
of costs.
Yeah.
You know?
Our health insurance here yeah sucks dick.
Yeah. Like my mom had a surgery last year, and end to end through all, like, you know, she had to do like MRIs and stuff like that. Here, including the procedure, that probably would have been what, six figures?
Yeah.
She paid like out of pocket, maybe like $50.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And that's just like what, a copay kind of a thing.
That's crazy.
Yeah. The only thing that's different is that you might have to wait a little longer.
Mm.
Like they obviously have a triage system where they, you know, would prioritize like life-threatening issues first.
Yeah.
So if it's something that can wait a little bit, you know, depending on what the doctor mm-hmm recommends or based on their analysis, then yeah, they're going to let you wait.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a comprehensive system.
That's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
So wait, so the government will give you assistance. Like, let's say, like, I don't know, I'm in Sweden you know, I lost my fucking job. Right.
Yeah.
And so they have a government institution for me to go to that I could sign up for that'll give me government assistance until I find a new job.
Yep. So as long as you show up to like the like job center or whatever it is, like there, a lot of things are centralized there.
Yeah.
Even like booze, they don't have liquor stores. They have liquor stores, what? But it's owned by the government.
Oh, really?
It is, yeah. I don't know if it's changed now, but at least to the best of my knowledge, it's still like, I mean, it's like a regular retail store. Mm-hmm. It's all just one chain. So imagine a BevMo being the only liquor store you have, but it's also tied into like the government.
Wait,
somehow.
Why does the government? Oh.
I don't know. I think they're trying to like manage consumption.
Uh-huh.
I think that's what it is. I know some grocery stores will or have started carrying like beer and maybe wine.
Yeah.
But if you want to get like hard liquor, you can't just go to a grocery store and pick it up off the shelf.
Oh, got
yeah,
you.
You got to go to these places. And I'm not quite sure. I don't think they track, like you don't have to like give them your ID or something mm-hmm unless you look, you know, underage. But
they can track, let's say, for example, like you drove like you were drunk or whatever. They could track how much liquor you bought or.
Maybe. I don't know if that's. I don't think they surveil you like that,
yeah,
right? I just think that they're trying to, maybe what they're trying to do is like, if they see like, okay, we want to not like encourage people to drink that much, maybe they drive the prices up. So it could
you
be stuff like that.
Okay.
And that's easier to do if you handle the retail.
That's so weird. I didn't know that alcohol was like a government subsidy in fucking Sweden. That's
Well, it's not a subsidy, but it's controlled to a certain extent. Yeah.
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 That's fucking odd.
Yeah, it's interesting. And the same thing with
I read an article about like the Swedish prison system.
Yeah.
That, can I go to prison in fucking Sweden?
Dude, it's like
that shit's nice.
It's nicer than most countries.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think all Scandinavian countries share that. Like it's more of a therapeutic kind of a system.
It seems very based on rehabilitation. Like,
it does.
They definitely don't treat, like, I saw one of the rooms, yeah, right? And there was a lamp. There was a, you know.
You have a little TV. I think you have cable, or I think you just can't have like a cell phone and like connection to the outside world. Like,
yeah.
You probably have like a computer room for you to like get online and stuff.
Yeah.
But you just might not have that in your, I don't even want to call it a cell. It's like your dorm room. Your dorm. Yeah.
Yeah. When I saw a photo of it, yeah, I think it was like a 3D modeling of it.
Yeah.
It was like an article that I read about a new prison that was going to come up in Sweden or something like that. Right. And I just looked at it. I was like, shit looks like fucking IKEA.
Yeah. I mean,
it looks like an IKEA room.
It's like, you know, it's got a mattress. And this is all anecdotal for me, like based on what I've seen as well.
Mm-hmm.
I might be dead wrong, but it's from what I understand, it's got a mattress.
This podcast is brought to you by HelloFresh. If you want to make delicious foods at your home in pre-measured amounts with the easiest step-by-step recipes, that's HelloFresh. Yet dummies, every meal that I've made has been delicious. And because every ingredient is exact, you won't have leftover scraps, veggies, or sauces to clutter up your fridge that you know you won't use. I know who you are, and who you are is me, R. I mean, that's me. I always have leftover foods for no reason because I keep buying these ingredients only for the recipe, and I got all this leftover stuff that I never use and it goes to waste. HelloFresh offers contactless delivery. They have different categories of meals such as low calorie, vegetarian, and family friendly recipes every week, and you can save up to 28% by using HelloFresh versus your grocery store shopping trips. If you want to be full and happy like me, go to HelloFresh.com/80brain and use code 80brain to get a total of $80 off, including free shipping on your first box. That's HelloFresh.com/80brain and use code 80brain to get a total of $80 off and free shipping. Additional restrictions apply. Please visit HelloFresh.com for more details.
You know, got a little TV. I think you even have like a, or you can have like a video game console. So that's just to pass your time. Man. But the thing is, like, they'll offer full on like university courses there. So you can go into jail and leave with a freaking bachelor's degree.
That's amazing.
That's like, you know, co-tutored by the local whatever university or school.
It's really interesting because, you know, people in the United States, we talk about our prisons and they call them correctional facilities, right? But nobody ever goes into our prison and they rarely ever come out better.
Yeah.
You know, because the hard thing is when we talk about our, I don't know if, you know, I'm pretty sure everybody knows this, but when you go to jail and you come back out, the likelihood that you're going to get a very solid career after that, where you're going to make ends meet with your job, is going to be really, really hard.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to hire an ex-convict.
For sure. And that's going to show up on your record when they run a background 100%. Check and stuff like that.
But if you go to prison in Sweden, can you also go to the government and they'll help you out, or how does that work?
Yeah, I think so. I don't know for sure, but I think they also have this thing where it's going to show up on your record, right? So that might also be a problem. But I think they're more lenient towards that over there because it's...
I need to kill somebody in Sweden and see what happens.
Well, you're not going to get life in jail. Well, even if you do, it's like 20 years.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's like the... When they say life, again, this could have changed because it's been a minute since I read up on it. But from what I understand, like... The life sentence there does top out at a certain amount of time.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
So they are about rehabilitation.
Yeah, for sure. Rehab is the number one like goal of it, right? And it should be.
Mm-hmm.
One big difference is it's not private institutions for correctional facilities.
Okay.
Because, you know, a lot of these, and that's something I find interesting here too, is that some of these correctional facilities that exist are like there is
they're a business.
Private. Yeah, it's a business.
Yeah.
The more inmates they have.
The more money
they can charge.
Yeah.
Right. Which is an interesting model. Like, I don't know if I personally agree with that being the right way about it. Like, I just feel like there's a conflict of interest there somehow. You know?
Why'd you want to come from Sweden to the United States then?
I mean, because it's still like the US is the US, right? Like, this is a country of anything can happen here.
Yeah.
Good or bad. There are no limits, and that's kind of like the way that the nation has been positioning themselves for the last, what, ever since it was founded.
Yeah.
Right? So it's still like the cultural epicenter of the world. It's still the leader in the world in many aspects.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it's like growing up primarily consuming content that came out of here, whether it be visual, like, you know, film or TV or music. It's just like you establish a connection to the culture here And I think a lot of people who come here that are foreigners, like first gen immigrants, can attest to that. Like there is something that anchors you to the culture here that you might not have had in your home country, wherever that is, you know? Like for me, one thing that I didn't realize was, and I think I mentioned this last time too, like I only came here to accompany a homie of mine, Cam, who I came here with initially. And the plan was only to see this as an extended kind of vacation, right? Like I had just got done with high school, took a sabbatical to figure out what I wanted to do. I worked at McDonald's and shit, right? And figured, you know what, let's just go to LA for like a year, you know, to take a course and see what happens. And I think coming here for me, especially being surrounded with a lot of Asian culture and Asian people, something I didn't have the luxury of in my hometown, just really helped me find my identity as an Asian man.
Yeah.
You know, and really start to appreciate, because I remember as a kid, dude, and you can probably attest to this too, like growing up in SAC, it's like you being the super minority just, you know, made you feel like an outsider, made you feel hard to connect with your culture.
Yeah.
Made you almost a little embarrassed sometimes. Like, whether it be the food that you ate. I remember my mom used to make this mean tofu thing I freaking loved, right? But kids would always laugh. I'm like, ew, what the hell is that? They would eat like some bullshit, like some sandwiches and some shit, right?
I don't know what Sweden people talking about. Your fucking food's weird, dog.
Dude.
Y'all got fucking Swedish meatballs and then you got fucking pickled herring.
That shit is bomb. Yo, pickled herring, bro? The mustard pickled herring? I'm going to bring some next time, bro. Shit is bomb. Ooh, and some boiled mini potatoes with some dill, bro.
Dog, nobody is ever listening to this podcast and nobody's mouth is watering right now. This was that boiled potatoes and pickled herring. What do you want that in fucking prison food?
It's fucking delicacy, dude. Put that on some crackers.
I actually like pickled herring, but I don't know about eating it like that, though.
Well, it is traditional. We'll have to do a little.
When you were in Sweden, were you like, when you went to school, were you like the only Asian kid there?
Definitely, I could count on one hand how many Asian kids were there.
What's that like? Because that place is white as fuck.
And you know, and for the most part, they were probably related to me somehow.
Mm.
So that's why also like it was weird, you know, even like appreciating Asian women in a way where like I could foresee myself or see myself being in a relationship with them was weird, because a lot of times I would only interact with people who I might be related to.
Yeah.
So I could never really see them as like a desirable partner, you know, which was weird. Coming here, there were a lot more people that I couldn't say for sure, but most likely wouldn't be related to, right? And just being in that sphere and learning how to appreciate my culture,
yeah,
or our culture, you know. So for me, it was and I think that's why it kind of grew more on me being here in LA, especially is the fact that I really found who I was here, not only as like, oh, a singer, artist, or whoever it is, or whatever it is that I do, but just me as a person, as an Asian man in the world, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I couldn't imagine growing up in because it's not even just your school, it's the country. Like there's not much diversity, obviously, in Sweden as it is compared to the United States, right? It's just it's hard for me to figure out like if I would have been able to like culturally connect to who I am if I wasn't surrounded by other people who were very like-minded or understood the culture as well.
Right.
Right. Because it would just, I mean, how? I would feel left out. I'd probably, you know, adapt the other way around.
No, for sure. And that's the thing. Like you would try to assimilate as much as possible.
Yeah.
You know? And I was never given a Anglo-Saxon or Swedish name.
Yeah.
You know? So I was always sticking out, regardless how hard I tried, you know, to fit in. One thing that I found interesting, like growing up, it wasn't that much diversity. It's definitely really diverse now, especially my hometown.
Mm-hmm.
Most people are from like the Middle East, could be, you know, maybe refugee backgrounds or whatever it may be. There's a big Middle Eastern influence.
Mm.
But even then, what I found interesting was like the native, like the white people of Sweden could definitely claim that as like, yo, this is ours. Mm. Like we were here not only for like, we didn't have the whole, like, you know, the US is like the melting pot where, you know, Europeans came here to look for, you know, freedom of suppression from like, you know, religious freedom, whatever it may be. Yeah. Right. Like they can say that they can track to when they actually came here.
Oh,
sweet. Well, I mean, like the Europeans that came to the US, right? So you could say like, hey, you guys were immigrants too.
Uh-huh.
But you can't really say that for Swedish folks. So if they say like, oh, but you're in our country, like what are you supposed to say?
Yeah.
I can't say, well, y'all came here too. Like, you know, the like, original this is Neanderthals us. Were fucking like, no, like, yeah, I'll give that to them. Like, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
This is your country. Yeah. So
are there a lot of, are there white nationalists in Sweden?
Oh, for sure, dude.
Oh, okay.
Like neo-Nazis and shit. That's huge.
Oh, really?
Yeah, dude. I would see even like the area of town I grew up in, there were, because especially my mom ran a restaurant, right?
Yeah.
So a lot of people, patrons that came were just like, came to have a few beers, but frequently. Mm-hmm. I don't want to call them alcoholics.
Yeah.
But basically that's what they were, right?
Yeah.
There were a lot of people who were, you know, rocking like the Confederate flags and shit. They like had a connection to this whole movement here, even though they
were. They would go to a Chinese restaurant?
Yeah. Well, that was the only watering hole available.
That's so fucking weird. It's like.
Dude, we had a 1 year, I remember, there was like a viewing party. We had a reservation at the restaurant for like a big event, right?
Mm-hmm.
They had reserved like 5 or 6 tables because they were there to watch like this whole election thing.
Mm-hmm.
It was, I remember it was a year where there were elections happening and they were there that election night to kind of follow like, you know, what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then I realized, you know, there were a lot of people, they were all white, which wasn't surprising. I mean, that's pretty normal to see. But there were some that were just like shaved heads and stuff. I'm like, okay, you know, maybe they just lost their hair. But then there was this lady that came up to pay. And I saw the, how like engaged they were with the whole election process and like the results coming in and stuff. I just casually asked her like, hey, because I was helping out my mom that night. I was like, hey, so are you guys like with a political party or something? And she was.
Mm-hmm.
So that whole group were with a party called the Swedish Democrats. That have gained a lot of traction in the last few election cycles.
Mm-hmm.
And even though they might not claim to be like rooted in nationalism, that's kind of like what they're known for, being like founded by people who have been like, you know, white supremacists or something. So it was kind of weird to me that they chose a local Chinese restaurant to.
Yeah, that's the weird thing, right? It's that part.
Yeah.
It's like, how can you, that's where I have a probably the biggest confusion when it comes to people who have like national pride or like their ethnic pride, right? It's like, you can't have your cake and eat it too.
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
You can't, it's not that you can't, in my personal opinion, it's fucking dumb that you do.
Yeah.
For you to sit there and be like, okay, fuck everybody else. Like, right. We're the best shit on the world. What do you want to go eat? Some Chinese food.
Yeah.
Bitch, take my food out your fucking mouth.
Yeah. Get the fuck out of here.
The fuck out of here. Yeah. Watch, go eat your fucking Icelandic fish and boiled potatoes.
Boiled potatoes and herring and
go
shit.
Eat your fucking fish in a can and enjoy the fuck. Don't eat my fucking food then.
But you know what was interesting? Because I think when she saw my reaction, because I was jarred when she said that she was with that party, because I felt like, you know, it's kind of scary if you have a group of like, and mind you, Swedish people are in size pretty big.
Yeah, they're big people.
Tall and like wide.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm pretty short. Like you're big, you know, like in terms of your height.
Yeah, but they're
built
different though.
They're built differently for sure. So I felt like, you know, just a little intimidated, especially I was kind of young then too. Mm-hmm. But I think she saw like the change in my face when she mentioned that she was with that party. And she, I don't know. She felt compelled to kind of explain herself to me. You know what she said? She said, we don't, she came back afterwards. She was like, just to make things clear, like we don't like hate or despise people like you who are like doing your part in working hard. I'm paraphrasing, but that's basically the essence of what she's saying, right? Which I find kind of interesting. So basically what they're saying is we don't want people to come and leech. We want people who come here to work hard.
And contribute.
Mm. And not just be leeching from the system.
Yeah.
So like as much as I might not agree with all of the nuances of that statement, there are certain things that I do kind of understand.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's fucking interesting. Well, this is the weird part, right?
Yeah.
Because that's when I got confused when he was doing that interview and he was talking to that white nationalist and he goes, I don't hate your skin color. I don't hate any of your cultures.
Yeah.
I just want, you should be as racist as I am.
You know? Right.
You should not want people to come into your country and take it over. Like, I don't want you to come and take over mine.
Yeah.
Come visit, do whatever. But after you, you know, but for in her case, it's not even that. It's, you know, come to this country, but contribute.
Yeah.
You know, and is maybe she's talking about in terms of that with like refugees.
I think so.
Yeah.
Because I think just traditionally they've been Sweden as a country have been pretty generous in terms of welcoming and taking people in from a humanitarian perspective, which is dope, right? But at the same time, maybe not have the best system set up in terms of integrating people.
Yeah.
So what's happened is, from what I understand, like a lot of people who come have brought their baggage with them.
Yeah.
So if they have gang affiliations in their home countries, that shit transfers over. And they start to have like gang wars like that aren't even like rooted in anything that's local, but they just brought with them from their cultures.
Yeah.
Well, like there were issues I remember growing up where, I mean, albeit rarely, but it did happen where, you know, a dad from like a Middle Eastern family might feel like his daughter dishonored the family and then he just killed her. Like honor killings.
Oh shit.
Yeah, that definitely happened. I remember at least one or two cases just growing up, and I'm sure it's probably gone on.
Then I wonder if Sweden had a huge, or maybe people in Sweden might have had a huge issue with the Syrian refugees then that were coming in. Was that a big thing in Sweden?
Well, I think a lot of them were going towards Sweden.
Yeah.
Like they were either, I think once they got to like the EU, they just took the train and were going up to Germany or Sweden because they had a pretty open like policy.
Especially because you guys have, you know, that the socialist system set up to allow government assistance and help.
Right.
So,
And also, you know, once they get in and if they do become like residents or citizens, like that's a European Union citizenship.
Yeah.
They can go wherever they want after that.
Mm.
Except for the UK now, obviously.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah,
right.
Brexit.
Yeah. And I think that's kind of a part of it too. That's why they wanted to pull out, because they were like, well, you know, we're not centralizing our policies in terms of how we're approaching immigration.
Oh.
I don't think that's what they ran on, but that could have been
a factor.
Been a part of it. Yeah, for sure.
That's so interesting too, though. Like it's weird for me to hear that because situations are different, right?
Yeah.
So I know like some of these arguments too are what people say about people of color in this country.
Right.
Right. But I think like the biggest difference is that people who come to their country was there by choice.
Yeah.
Like they wanted to come here.
Right.
You know, versus like you can't say that to people of color, like for example, like black people, because they were brought here as chattel, as property.
Yeah. Right.
So, and there's a fucked up system that was forced to keep them down.
Yeah.
However, there's the Swedish situation is a little different. It's like you guys came here for whatever, like political freedom.
Yeah.
Or, you know, you guys came here as a refugee. We took you in.
Yeah.
And like I said, I'm not agreeing or disagreeing because I don't know anything about that country.
Right.
But when those people in that group party is like, you can come in here, but you can't, but you have to contribute to our country as well.
Right.
You know, after we took you in.
Yeah. Cause they can, I mean, it's hard to say, but I feel like they have a better opportunity to lay claim of the country versus European immigrants here. Like essentially when I say European,
they stole this land. So their foundation is all fucked up.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Like, you know, you can kind of argue like, well, y'all didn't, you know, y'all also came here.
Yeah.
Right. Whereas in other countries, you might be able to track it back to like, okay, y'all were the original inhabitants of this land.
Yeah.
So it is kind of hard, right, to see that and be able to kind of like speak against it. Like, I guess you could also say like, hey, you know, we are contributing, you know, but in just being more, asking people to be more empathetic about, because everybody's lives is not linear, right?
So when did your dad come to Sweden then? He was born in China.
Yeah. Born in China. Dude, my dad's story is freaking crazy, dude. I'm sure we've talked about this before.
We glanced over it.
We did, yeah.
Yeah.
So he's been all over the place. He definitely was in China. He got exiled because he was fighting against the whole communist takeover thing.
Mm-hmm.
So he got exiled to Taiwan. He went to Japan. And then somehow, ultimately, he made his way to Europe, right? Through Macau and through his Portuguese citizenship. Because remember,
what
Macau?
The fuck?
Macau used to be, yeah. And I think that's how he had last name Da Silva at some point. Which I'm like, what the fuck? Where the fuck did that come from? Like, where the fuck did that come from? Yeah, because one of my siblings, his name, half siblings, his name is Da Silva. Like, last name.
And he or she's what, full Chinese? No.
No, half Danish.
Oh, what the fuck?
Because his wife or lady at the time, my dad's then wife or lady was Danish. And then ultimately he went to Denmark and met my mom in Denmark.
Oh, yeah. Well, what was your mom doing in Denmark?
Well, she just wanted out of communist China.
Mm.
And so she had an uncle there in Denmark. Was it an uncle? Yeah, her uncle was there already. I don't know how he got there. But then she just basically, he helped her to get to Denmark. And then they met there and then they moved to Sweden, which is the neighboring country.
What the fuck? Your dad's last name was Da Silva for a bit. That's
dude,
funny.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I was like, what the hell? Yeah, it's super weird. But, you know, we can dive into that deeper because there's like, there's still question marks to what exactly my dad did.
Yeah.
Like, he was, I remember growing up, he was always away. Like, he was always traveling. But then I'd find pictures in his room of like bulletproof vests and stuff. So I'm like, wait, what did you do? And, you know, my dad passed away a few years ago, so I don't have the opportunity to ask him. And even then, when I was, when I did have the opportunity to talk to him about these, he would just brush it off like, ah, don't worry about it. Like,
wait, what was the bulletproof vest for?
I don't know. I just saw like, you know, before, you know, it was like printed photos of like a hotel room. So imagine your quintessential hotel or motel room. You open the door and you see like two beds, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the picture had these two beds and it was just like Kevlar vests on them.
And I'm like, what?
I'm like, why? First of all, what? Second of all, why are there, yeah. Why are there Kevlar vests in this picture? So yeah, I honestly, there's still a question mark to what exactly he did. He will always say, oh, I'm going away on business, right?
But never tell you what it is.
Never really go into detail of what that business entailed.
Yeah.
You know, and he would say like, oh yeah, you know, I'm working on like European and Asian, like as a consultant for relations and like trade,
mm-hmm.
But trade of what?
Yeah. Trade of what?
Yeah. So, you know, that's definitely still because my dad, including me, had like 9 kids.
Oh shit.
Yeah. Each of us had like a different period or era of time that we lived with our dads. So I think one of my life goals is to kind of tie those that timeline together. Like, what did you guys know about dad? And
are they all in, are all your siblings in Sweden?
No, actually, my oldest sibling is here in Oregon.
Oh,
yeah, she lives on a little farm. My oldest brother is actually here in Arcadia. Like literally.
Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah, like literally right here. And I met him for the first time just a few years ago. Like when I first came to the US, a few years after that, I found
and
out
he
that
was born here or no?
No, he was born in, I think, Thailand. Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying, bro. It's all over the place. And it's such an interesting story.
Man, your dad's Alexander Hamilton, dude. He just becomes a random ass kid.
Well,
what the
I
fuck?
Mean, low key, like, you know, people were like, because he was friends with a senator of Ohio or something at some point, like really close friends with him. Like, I think my dad had either a citizenship here at some point.
Or your dad had a U.S. citizenship?
Well, either citizenship or like a residency, like a what was before the green card, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So that's what I was told. He would say that to me because he's just like, oh, man, you know, if I knew you were wanting to move to the U.S. one day, I would have just maintained my status. Like basically renewed it. He just never renewed it. And I'm like, well, how did you get it in the first place? He's like, oh, yeah, I was really close friends with one of the senators here.
How?
So that's what I'm saying. I don't know. And then, you know, there were, because my dad at some point in his life also had a Chinese restaurant in Denmark. That's how he ended up there, right?
Yeah.
But there were rumors about like it being where it was located was very interesting. It was apparently located, this was before I came around, it was apparently located right between the US and the Russian embassy. And from what I've heard, and I don't know, I can't verify if this is true or not, that there were instances where there would be like dining guests from each of these embassies that came, and then he had shut down the restaurant because they were there at the same time. So I don't know if it's like anything more than what it is at face value, but those are things that I'm definitely would be looking into uncovering a little bit more if I have the time to
what
just
the fuck? Dive so, so your dad had a kid in Thailand.
He had two kids, two kids in Thailand who both live here now in the States. And then their kids are my age.
Oh.
So they're like, they could be like, they're at the age of my parents, basically. My dad was significantly older than my mom, right?
Yeah.
And then he had, I believe, two kids. I don't know if they were born in the Philippines, but I know that they grew up there. Or they spent some time there, for sure.
With your dad?
Well, yes and no. Like, I think so. I think he was around, but he would probably be traveling. Well, either way, I have two brothers that I knew or know spent some time. They had the Danish mom.
Mm-hmm.
I know that they spent some time in the Philippines. And then they moved to Denmark. And then my dad moved to Denmark too, I think. There he had another daughter, one of my older sisters, with a different lady. And then he moved to Sweden, I think. And then he had two other kids. One of my brothers and sisters that are half Swedish, right?
With a Swedish lady.
With a Swedish lady who was, I think, a stewardess, like a air host, like an air stewardess.
The fuck?
And then my mom.
And then he met your mom.
Yeah. And then since then, I don't know if there are, because he was traveling a lot. I don't know if I have other siblings, to be honest with you. I might have.
What the fuck?
You know, I don't know. Like at this rate, you know, who knows, right?
Your dad was just straight fucking, man.
Dude, I'm like freaking like Asian Austin Powers, bro.
Dude, what is
like,
going on?
That's what I'm saying. Like, nobody really knows. Like, I don't really know. I would love to know. I would love to
I'm trying to figure out what his job entailed that he would have to know a senator. He knows all these like high government officials.
Yeah.
That he's connected with all this stuff. Then there's this random picture of him in a hotel with a bunch of Kevlar vests on his, like, I don't understand that. Like, what the fuck is going on?
Like, was he a spy?
Yeah, I think he was a government spy, bro. You
know, like, what was that? What it was? Like, I don't know. I would love to learn, and this could be one of those.
You have to backtrack a lot and just kind of pick up all these stories between your siblings.
You just have to interview everybody. Like, what is your memory? You know, what is your recollection? Anything weird happened during
like some kind of story that they would say? Because that's so fucking odd to me,
dude. Yeah. This could be like a crime podcast series or something.
You think your dad was like a government agent?
I don't know. Well, here's the thing. He was so weird because he was elected to some kind of like a Chinese government party thing. He had the stamp in his passport where it kind of gave him clearance to some stuff. I don't know exactly what it was. But I don't know. There's just things that have happened that I've seen that is just like, it's kind of odd. It's a little weird.
Have you asked your mom? Does your mom know?
She doesn't know. Maybe she's just saying that she doesn't know.
Yeah.
But as far as I know, she doesn't know. Yeah.
She was like, dad just always worked.
It was always away. Like, dude, I remember there were times in where he would come back, literally, like he would come back from a trip overseas. Like be home for a few hours and then depart again, same day. And then I wouldn't see him for a week or 2 weeks or whatever it would be.
What the fuck? So it was your mom running the restaurant then?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. She was like she was there the majority of the time. My dad, and well, to the best of my recollection, was kind of in and out. Like towards, obviously, towards these latter years.
When you got older?
Yeah, I got older and for sure was more present.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was a kid, like in the late 80s, early 90s, there was definitely a lot of times where I didn't see him.
How's the relationship like with your dad and his other kids then? Because it seems like he was around for you the most.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, I definitely feel... Not sympathy. I don't feel bad, but I just feel like, you know, there's definitely an empathetic feeling that I have for my siblings that might envy that, like from the outside, you know, like looking in and seeing like, oh, Pops is spending more time with this kid. Like, you know, I can see that. And, you know, it's not my fault, right, directly, but I feel them. But I would say that, you know, it's been spotty. Maybe not on best terms with everybody. But everybody showed up to the funeral, though, which is really?
All the kids?
Yeah. Well, all the kids that we know about.
Yeah, all the kids that you know about. So it was a total of 9 kids.
Yeah. Give or take, yeah.
Are you the only kid that he had with your mom?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Yep. So between my parents, I was the only one. And then, yeah, for the most part, they came in pairs, except for one sister who's also the only child. Yeah.
What in the fuck? And did you meet their parents too or no?
Yeah, I think I've met all the other ladies actually.
You got to talk to them. They would probably know better.
Yeah, probably.
It's like, hey, like, what the fuck did my dad do?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I don't fucking know.
Yeah.
So weird.
Super weird, dude. It's definitely a story that, you know, I aim to dig a little bit deeper into going forward.
What? That's fucking weird,
fucking,
man.
Austin Powers, bro.
Yeah, your dad is Austin Powers.
International Man of Mystery, man.
I know exactly what my dad was doing. My dad was just working at the store and beating my ass all day. That's all. I know his story.
Oh, my dad beat my ass too, dude. No mercy.
I already know like the story of my dad. My dad's nothing like that. My dad just has a really tragic story when he was younger. Like, it's so funny because you get to kind of understand who he is and what he went through and why he kind of treated me the way he did because of how he grew up.
Right.
And I got to know everything about my father through my mom because my dad isn't really open like that. He doesn't really talk about his personal life.
Yeah.
Like my dad, I think my grandpa was somebody who was really wealthy. So he used to own, he used to be in manufacturing. Mm-hmm. And so he had like this Tupperware, this company that basically manufactured like Tupperware stuff, right?
Right, right.
Had a lot of money. So when my dad was really young, he was actually pretty well off. And then my grandpa had a habit of kind of trusting his money to other people. So when he was into this business, he didn't really know how it worked or anything else.
Yeah.
He probably just made the right investments, knew the right people. So because of that, because he didn't have the knowledge of how this business ran or where the money was coming in and out,
right,
eventually his business partners took all of his money. And so he ended up being broke. But by the time he was broke, my sisters were already old enough and they were married off or they kind of went off and did their own thing.
Yeah.
My dad was still really young.
Right.
And so during this time, I remember this weird moment where he has an older sister, right? And let me tell you, this bitch crazy. Like both my aunts are fucking crazy.
Yeah.
But I remember I saw my aunt and my oldest aunt, who I just met at the time for the first time ever.
Yeah.
She came into the United States to see my brother, to see her brother, my dad, and her sister. Mm-hmm. And I remember my aunt and her got into a fucking fight, like a crazy fight. This is like, they're old. They're like in their, what, 50s, 40s,
right,
high 40s. And I just remember they were fucking screaming at each other. My aunt spit in her face and she scratched his fat.
What?
I scratched her face up. I was like, "Yo, what the fuck is going on?"
But damn, dude.
I guess my parents never really got my dad and his siblings never really got along.
Like,
he still doesn't really get along with his older sister that lives here.
Oh,
and that's my aunt that I was pretty close to because I saw her growing up a lot because I'm really close to her kids.
Is she cousins. In NorCal too, or
yeah, she's in Sacramento.
Oh, okay.
And my oldest aunt, I remember I came downstairs. Oh, not downstairs. I came into the living room. And I just remember seeing my oldest aunt sitting there just crying, like begging my dad for forgiveness.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was for, but she was just crying her eyes out, begging him for forgiveness. And she came to the States because her husband just passed away.
Oh.
What I found out later on was because when they were younger, when my grandpa went bankrupt, he didn't have any money, lost everything, right?
Right.
The older sisters were already gone. They were off. They had their own men or whatever. Yeah. They were set. But my brother was still living in the household. He was like still in high school or like a 14 year old or some shit.
Yeah. Yeah.
So at that point, what happened was, to keep a long story short, my oldest aunt took in her father, my dad's dad as well, obviously, took him in, but she said that my brother couldn't live with them though. So he had to figure it out for himself as like a 14 year old.
What?
Yeah. And I think it's because her husband didn't want him living in the house with
Why?
Them. I don't fucking know. So my dad had to fend for himself at the age of like 14 or 15.
That's crazy.
So he got taken in by his best friend's parents, yeah, who owned a motel, and he let him stay live in the one of the rooms while he was going to school and doing everything else.
Damn, that wasn't here.
That, right? Was in Korea.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And so she came and basically asked my dad for forgiveness from, yeah, what happened back. And then that's why she was sobbing and crying. Obviously, yeah, she went through a very traumatic experience because, right, she lost, right, her husband.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that's the kind of like background that my dad grew up in. So, yeah, he really did have to fend for himself.
Yeah.
And so my dad, I think he was really harsh on us, and he really wanted to keep a tight-knit family,
yeah,
because he didn't have a tight-knit family growing up.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest fallacy in that was that because he was trying to keep us so close, he was, yeah, kind of pushing us away,
yeah,
because he didn't let us breathe.
Right, right.
Because he was basically trying to fulfill a childhood that he never had, that, yeah, that to him was very important.
Yeah.
And you know, to his credit, like, family is very important to me, yeah, because of him. But then I got to hear these stories from my mom about how he grew up, because he never told me this stuff.
Right.
Like, I feel like Asian men don't ever fucking tell.
No, dude. Yeah. I mean, even like a basic thing, like saying like, I love you. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Like, as much as we love our parents, I'm sure, like, I feel like I say love you more to my friends than I actually say it to, yeah, my mom. You know what, yeah, I mean? Which is weird, even though, you know, obviously the type of love you have for your parents is on a whole different level than,
yeah, it just wasn't there. No, we never really said it. I say, yeah, it to my mom now, but that took time.
Yeah.
You know, my dad never said it to me. I don't think it's in his vocabulary. And I get it too. I understand it's not in my vocabulary to say it to him either.
Yeah.
I'm just like, all right, man.
All right. You know? All right. Okay.
You know, but my dad shows his love. You know, I showed you the stuff that my dad made back at home, the garden. Yeah. I mean, that's how he shows his love through, yeah, stuff like that. Like, I, yeah, told him, like, hey, I wish I could make this. He goes, I'll make it for you.
Yeah. And I think, you know, to a certain point, you know, it can be left unsaid. I mean, it's nice to say it, but, mm-hmm, you know, if you have a good relationship, which involves, like, you know, butting heads at times,
mm-hmm,
I think it can be left unsaid and just be known, right?
Yeah, like, I'm okay with it because there's other ways to show that, like, affection and, right, love.
Exactly.
And I think, you know, obviously our generation is going to be a lot different.
Yeah.
We're just going to do it the way that we do it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, like, all of our parents are kind of the way that they are because of something that happened to them. Like, yeah, I would have never known about this stuff about my dad unless my mom told me.
Right, right.
And he had a really, really rough upbringing. Like, I didn't get it. And then when we grew up too, like, we were super poor too.
Yeah.
Like, we had to kind of figure things out as we went.
Yeah.
Like, I remember just small things of, I didn't really have, like, new clothes ever. Yeah. Like, until I was, like, maybe, like, in junior high. Everything, right, was a hand-me-down, or there was a... Next to this joint in Sacramento called Rice Bowl,
yeah,
there was a thrift store. And that's where I got all my clothes.
Yeah.
I got all my clothes. It was all used stuff. It was super cheap. And we, mm-hmm, just got all of our stuff there. And then my brother got his clothes there.
Yeah.
And then I got his hand-me-down, which was already a hand-me-down that he bought at the thrift store. You know, and that was just our everyday existence. We just, yeah, didn't have a lot of money. It wasn't something that was there.
Yeah.
And I didn't really think twice about it.
Yeah.
And I remember our store too. All of our supplies were on cardboard boxes because we couldn't afford shelves.
Mm.
Like, so, and it was so funny because when I look back at it now, I didn't think I was poor. I just thought that was life.
Yeah.
That's just how everybody was. Like, we were in a low income area.
Yeah.
Everybody didn't have money.
Yeah.
But the weirdest part was, like, because we owned a business, I think a lot of people in the neighborhood thought that we were well off.
Yeah.
It's like, bro, I live in your same fucking neighborhood.
Right.
Like,
right.
You know where I live. Like, yeah, you guys know I'm just as broke as you guys.
Yeah, right.
You know, but they saw that we owned a business. So they're like, oh, you have more than us. But that wasn't the case.
Yeah.
You know, they didn't know how hard it was for us. I think our business started taking a really good turn in profit just to bring us up to lower middle class.
Yeah.
Not just out of poverty was, right, like, right, when I was in junior high.
Right.
And then my parents bought me my first pair of Nike Air Maxes. It was the Air Max, I think it was the Air Max 95 where the bubble ran all the way through the back.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Was it
95? Not 90.
90? No, not 90. Wait. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It is 95.
Yeah. The 95s with the Air Max. Yep. It was like lime green in the bottom and shit like that. So there's, like, these moments that I get my dad. Like, his life was stressful. And he was going through seminary school at the time as he was, like, raising us.
Man.
Because he wanted to be a pastor.
Yeah. Right. Right.
So he went through seminary school. You know, he was going through, like, being broke as shit, had to run the business.
Yeah.
And then, you know, he was still having to take us to school. I sucked at school.
Yeah.
And then my brother was doing well. That's why he was the golden child at the
right
time. Yeah. But your dad's a fucking secret agent, dude. Just to let you know. He's a spy just trying to kill people.
I don't know, dude. Well, not killing nobody right now. Yeah. So
your parents ran away from China to kind of escape, like, communism.
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, it's kind of interesting to see their perspective because it's like getting away from, like, the whole Mao regime. But then looking back at it now with pride, like, I remember my dad was, at least in these last years, when he was still with us, like, he was super proud of the progress that was made over there.
Mm.
Like how much they've been able to grow and evolve. Because I think that's the main difference. If you think about like a dictatorship, right? Like if you look at Cuba, mm-hmm. or if you look at like another, like maybe South American country that's ran on the same type of concept, like Leninism or whatever it may be, mm-hmm. right? What China has done is they've opened themselves up for trade and capitalism in a way that's still very controlled.
Yeah.
And maybe it's just a sheer amount of people and their mentality of how they, like their work ethic, that just has really like propelled them into being one of the like a contender of like, you know,
mm-hmm.
a nation to be looking at. Like, did you ever see that documentary called like American Factory or something on Netflix?
Mm-mm.
Bro, you should watch that shit. It's so interesting. I think it was the first documentary. It got nominated for an Oscar. I don't know if it won it, but President Barack Obama and First Lady have like a production company now that they've actually invested or bought this documentary
mm-hmm.
and put on Netflix. Dude, it's so interesting. What they do is basically they go to Detroit, right? It's about like the auto factories there and how like they've shut down. And then they bring in a Chinese investor that opens like a car windshield company factory there.
Yeah.
Right. And it's basically following that journey and seeing how some of these American reps or factory workers go to China to get trained and just seeing the difference in work ethic and work culture. Dude, you just got to watch it, dude. And I recommend for everybody to watch it just to get an idea of how, you know, like linear people think over there and are just mm-hmm. very focused on task at hand. And I think that's maybe why there's so much manufacturing going on there, because there's less of this idea of, oh, I have an end goal in life. You know, I want to make it to X, Y, and Z. I want to become this or I want to become that. It's more so like, what can I do with what I've been given right now?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, that's even in our that's a reflection of our parents' generation too.
And yeah, for sure.
We have like small remnants of that as well.
Yeah.
And I always tell young people too right now, like if you're under the age of like 25 or some shit, like the biggest issue that most people have now is not because like it's not because you guys don't know what you want to do.
Yeah.
It's because you guys know too many of things that you want to do.
Yeah.
And you guys have options now.
Yeah.
You know, growing up for people like our parents, options wasn't anything. It was more like pay the bills, make sure that my kids are good, make sure that we set up for a future.
Yeah.
And that's that fuel that kind of kept them going for the day to day.
Yeah.
And so when you get burdened with too much choice, you kind of end up being really stagnant. You don't know what to do. It's not that you have too many choices. It's not that you don't have too many choices. You're not picking anything.
Right.
Right. And that's I think that's even sometimes harder. I feel bad for them sometimes.
And also the concept that, you know, and this is something that I definitely subscribe to, is like the concept, if you worked hard enough, anything is possible.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's necessarily true. Like, there is some serendipity in that. Like I definitely encourage everybody to work hard at something, but don't take like the result for granted, right? Like, let's say your dream is to become X. Like, nothing really is linear. Like, you can't predict that actually from happening. All you can do is ensuring that you're giving it your best. You know what I mean? Don't expect a return. I think that's what it is. Sometimes you can get so jaded, like, and feel butthurt. Like, why isn't this happening to me? I've invested so much time or this and that into this, but it's not rendering the result that I was promised.
Yeah, that it's because a lot of these fucking celebrities, they go out there, they kind of talk about their personal success and their stories, right? I was like, but there's a certain factor to the fact that you're a very talented human being.
Yeah.
You have this certain thing going for you.
Yeah.
Some of you motherfuckers, by the way, and this is like something I had to tell myself like growing up too, that kind of helped me from getting jaded, is that sometimes you're good at shit, sometimes you're bad at shit.
Yeah.
And you have to accept that.
Yeah.
They're like, I told a story before about this kid that I met in Buffalo, and it was during a talent show contest.
Yeah.
And Buffalo, New York, I got to tell you, man, out of all the talent shows that I've went to, you guys are some of the most untalented motherfuckers I've ever met in my life. Like,
damn.
Like, I'm telling you, this dude, he did a whole rendition of Lady Gaga's Ooh La 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 La.
Okay.
But he did it with a Chinese accent. And I've never laughed so hard in my life. I was cracking the fuck
up.
Wait,
what the Chinese accent was on purpose?
So I thought it wasn't on I thought it was on purpose. So I was cracking the fuck up. I was like, this dude is a funny ass comic. So I gave him like a 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
And then I was dying laughing in the front row, like literally tearing up.
Yeah.
And then we went to the back. They're like, oh, what did you give this guy? I forgot his name now.
Yeah.
But I gave him a 10. They're like, you sure? Like, he's the best? I was like, dude, fucking funniest act ever. He was like, David, he wasn't making an act. He was singing for real. And I laughed at him for his whole set.
Damn.
My ass off. But, you know, and so the reason why I bring this up is because afterwards he comes up to me and he goes like, hey, David, like, I heard you sing too. Maybe we should, you know, collaborate together.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you don't know how much you suck dick.
Oh, man.
You fucking suck.
Yeah.
But he doesn't know. So, and he told me that he wanted to drop out of college to pursue music. And wow. I'm like, bro, do not finish up college.
Yeah.
You're gonna need this, but that just goes to show sometimes we don't got shit that we want, and that's okay.
Yeah.
If you enjoy things, do it because you enjoy it.
Yeah.
But when you expect it, like a specific result to happen just because you worked hard towards it,
right,
it's not gonna happen. There's a reason why, especially when it comes to acting, there's only a finite amount of roles.
Right, for sure.
There's people who dedicate their whole lives to be an actor and they don't pop off because they think that they have something to offer. And I'm telling you, people right now, there are people that I know that are great actors.
Yeah.
And they haven't gotten their chances or roles yet.
Right.
You know, and they make okay money.
Yeah.
Not well.
Yeah.
They could probably do way better if they had a steady job.
Right, right.
But they do it because they love it and they enjoy the process.
Yeah.
Whether they pop off or not, they know that they've done something that they enjoyed for you know, for a majority of their life.
Yeah. And I think it's important to like take self-inventory, right? Like what you're saying right there with that guy that's saying, like, okay, let's say that just at face value, he's not quite where he needs to be, you know, a viable, like person in the marketplace for music, like an artist. Right.
Yeah.
But then know that and work on your craft.
Yeah.
Like if that's something that you really want to do, know how much you're sucking right now or where you're sucking and just really just evolve and try to grow, like take classes, whatever it may be, class.
Some people just don't know how bad they are, man. I just saw this video clip that my buddy showed me of this guy that decided that when he was going to get married, he was going to sing Bruno Mars, Versace on the Floor. Didn't even tell his fiance that he liked singing. And it was the worst fucking rendition I've ever heard in all my life. If I had a gun, I would have shot myself in the ears. Not to kill myself, just blasted my ears off.
Just to go deaf.
Just to go deaf for a hot second. It was so fucking bad. And then he had two dancers there.
Oh my God.
To perform fucking body worship or some shit as he's singing Versace on the Floor to her off key for a solid 4 minutes.
Dude, I can't watch those. It makes me cringe,
it's
bro.
It's so bad. It's a Vietnamese dude. It's like, bro, I don't remember the last time I heard a fucking dope Vietnamese R&B artist. So it's a tonal language.
Yeah, remember that Swedish dude I showed you?
Yes.
When you look at me.
Yeah. Dog, it was so bad. But dude, some people just don't know, man. Like these American Idol people,
yeah,
they're some of them are real human beings. Like they legit think that they're the shit.
Yeah.
Like William Hung thought he was dope.
But did he though?
I think he did.
He did?
I think he's a little odd.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like at some point you've got to know that you're not quite.
Dude, that guy, he did it. He performed at his fucking wedding. He didn't know, Z. He didn't fucking know.
Bro, I need to watch this shit,
If I showed it to you, dude, you would rip this mic and fucking stab your eye with it. It's so bad.
Man.
It's terrible. People don't have that self-awareness. We think people do.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I think I have a self-awareness of what I'm good and bad at.
You know? I mean, at least enough to know to be able to identify good from bad or whatever.
Exactly. Like even when it comes to something like kickboxing, right? There's people who come in and they think that they're the shit.
Yeah.
And they come in and they get their fucking ass whooped. And it's like, how did you talk all this shit?
Yeah.
And then you're still kidding, you're fucked up. It's because they don't have self-awareness. The people believe in their own bullshit.
Man.
It's sad, man.
So interesting, dude. So how did the wife react?
Oh, she was sitting there just smiling really awkwardly. Just like, oh, okay.
She was like, what is this?
Dude, if I was her, I'd be pissed. I was like, you ruined my wedding.
Like, you should have told me this before we got married.
She should have divorced him on the spot.
Oh, man. She
got married that day and divorced him that day.
Draft me the papers.
Exactly.
Damn.
Fuck that guy, dude.
Fuck, that's crazy, so odd, dude. Man.
It's just weird watching that happen when people don't have that amount of self-awareness.
Yeah, dude. I mean, I think maybe I'm just taking it for granted, like in terms of giving people the benefit of the doubt, but you know, you would think like it's not that hard. I mean, yeah, maybe not get, again, the full picture of where you're at, but at least a semblance of like, hey, maybe I can be better.
Yeah.
You know?
That's not going to happen for some people, man.
Oh, man.
Shit.
Yeah.
Well, guys, this wraps this episode of the Genius Brain Podcast. We learned a lot about this full CIA agent father.
Yeah, or whatever, man.
Whatever that shit is.
More to come on that. I'm sure we'll have to dive into that more.
But Z, where can they find you?
Oh, just online, you know, Dave's Music, wherever. Instagram, Z Woods.
Yeah, you can see him everywhere, man. Well, you guys, you know, we upload every Thursday and Sundays. Random Ass Podcast. Love you, sons of bitches, and we'll see y'all next time.
Peace out.